This is a blessed time indeed when the just will be able to go into a black hole of love, a bottomless excursion into paradise on earth. And if we would entertain the thought that optical illusions have been easy compared to the mystery of God, the mystery of God, which has been hidden for 2,000 plus years. And this has been an illusion greater than all others. So welcome to the black hole. It is the opposite of light. It is the darkest, gross darkness of all, the ignorance of love. And so in this hour, I come as the lawgiver of the law of love, so that no more will we have to look through darkness any longer with obscured vision. I welcome you to the heart of Christ. And as we do that, we can reveal the Trinity, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, Elohim. And who is he? He is the multiplicity of singularity, the Trinity of one. He is the God of all mankind, Jeremiah 32:27. He is the good shepherd over all the flocks of man, John 10. He has unconditional love for you and for I, not loving one of us above another. Who is he? He is Emmanuel, our God with us again very soon, if people will but embrace his love and the equality of his love, since he has never been a respecter of men as the false Christ that this world does celebrate. And so in this hour, it is time to look hard at the heart of Christ. And this is a representation of his heart of hearts, the deepest part that we have never been able to see. And if you notice, these are the flames that are under and within his passionate heart, his fervent heart, ready to explode with the fervency of the passionate of his benevolence and the magnificence of his beneficence, his adoration let loose for all the world to see. And no man comes to the Father but by the Son, for they are one in love. And all those who love are born of him and know him because he is love. And in this hour, it is clear that the true Lord has never been a respecter of men. He has loved and always shall love all of us identically the same. And all of us are saved if we do not commit blasphemy of the Holy Spirit to let love be cast out of us. Because if we let love be cast out of us, that is kicking Christ right out of our heart. For the Lord says, I am love. And I am the love that's living within the heart of man. For those who love are born of me and know me, because I am love, 1 John 4:7. And so as the fire of the passion of Christ, as that burns, and as within his heart, as that becomes a great inferno of passion, it is time to raise up the bar. Because as that burns, it reflects the glory rays coming out, and it will go farther than far, and yet by the Spirit it's as close as a breath and as far as away of the exhale of God's blessedness as he blows kisses towards all people of his love. For we are his beloved, we are his blessed, and we are all of those who should bow unto he whose name is love, the secret name of Christ. And as this fire burns away within the heart of Christ, it prepares a projectile to become as a ballistic missile, to shoot off the great climax of the ages. And these are the hands of Christ. Behold, his hands are not too short that they can save. And because of this, more than ever, we need to be clapping. Because when Christ's heart overflows with the passion of his love going before him, it is clear that he has arisen as the good shepherd of all the flocks of man, one who is the good shepherd who has overtaken his very own reaper in his harvest of love. For all nations are now his, and he is the Lord of all mankind. And for the Lord says unto all people willing to embrace his heart of hearts, he says, I am your God. You are my people. I have forgiven your iniquity, and I shall never remember it. And I shall write my law and my love upon your hearts. Beyond that, none shall ever even need to be taught of me. For all that know me, all that love as a child, with love that is alive as a verb, that is unconditional. For wide is the way unto hell, and it is paved by upside down love, love that has never been loyal and dedicated and faithful. So it's time to go down, thumbs down on that kind of love. For love to be love, it has to be in spite of kind of love that will be turned around so that thumbs up can always point up towards that ballistic climax of the ages, that we are at the crux of a new crucible, and the crucible is of our own bondage, and it is time for the shackles to be freed. Let the chains be ripped off of our wrists. And for in this hour of revelation, the wise may finally see, because the Lord God has brought forth now his message of Malachi 3:1 that prepares his way. And if his way is not prepared, he can in no wise return, as Acts 3:21 says of the great restoration that Peter said had to happen. And what restoration? Matthew 17:11, surely Elijah would restore all things. And of a spiritual understanding, I have now restored all things, because the message of Malachi 3:1 that prepares his way will bring life if it is not ignored, or it will bring death if it is. Even the death of Zephaniah 1:1, where it will become a bird with no a world with no birds, no fish, no mankind left at all. So let the glory of his love overflow upon you and your family, and the blessedness forever of he that is the beloved, the blessed, and the adored will be poured out. And say not to his flood of love to stop in the middle of your valley. He will uproot all the trees thereof. So stand with me now, for it is time to magnify our beloved. And in this hour, our majesty of majesties, he stands high and tall and proud, exalted evermore shall he be. And the glory of the Lord shall cover the earth as waters cover the sea, as grass cover the land, as sands cover the most desolate of deserts. It shall be as pink on a flamingo and a little green on a froggy. But one thing is for sure, as he shines forth the rays of his blessedness through his smile of kindness that transcends any and all religion, as he shines his pearly whites towards us, the glory of his love will magnify in our hearts if we will embrace the truth that he loved us far more than we ever loved him until and he had to be awakened within our hearts. So come out of the land of the walking dead, all who have allowed their love to become but as a noun instead of a verb. And so know that it has come to pass that the most regal eagle of the eons has come to transform, because it is time that the wise might shine as the stars, and there was no way to do that unless we go higher than we ever had before. Who will come and feed the master's household meat and food? Christ asked in Matthew 24:45. And this is the latter-day mountain covered with food, and upon this mountain will the wise beat their sword into the sickle to learn the ways of war no more, to change our conditional love, which has never been divine, and to beat that and change that into unconditional, so we can learn the ways of war no more. For wide is the way to hell paved with our conditional love, each and every day as we let it wax cold and practice how to let it become so desensitized that we're practicing how to learn how to be cast away, to be cast away into the outer darkness of lovelessness, where there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So embrace the Lord's heart of hearts and the fire thereof, and the projectile of his love will be like a rocket that will bring forth the fireworks of this age. For the fullness of the time has come of Gentiles, and it is come. And now the mystery of God is over. The seventh trumpet sounded first, and the first is last, and the last is certainly first, as Christ said many times. And so know that the time of great refreshing can never come until the Lord's message of his kingdom age covenant is shared by all people. What must come now is the shattering of the power of the holy people, Daniel 12:7, because God's word truly has only been closed until the time of the end, as it is written. And so people must realize that all of our religion is nothing but desolate heritages. For many shall say, Lord, Lord, we believed. And he's going to say, that never mattered. You let your love go out. You kicked me out of you. Get away from me. I never knew you. So it's time to look intently upon he who is the beloved, the blessed, and the adored. For he wants to have full attention of our heart, embracing his heart of heart. And so the spirit of prophecy through Christ comes, and he says, do not look to the world for fulfillment in matters of love, for you will never find me there. For I am love, says the Lord. I am longing for you and calling you now into my presence, the presence of the equality of my love for all my sons and daughters. And I desire intimacy and fellowship with every loving heart that will turn towards me. So the Lion of Zion is purring as softly as a little itty bitty kitty's most tender, loving, whispering kind of a purr. And he says, do not busy yourself in all the things of the earth, but be busy about my business of love, planting seeds. Get ready for the harvest, to reap the harvest of love. And so I will be able to refresh you and revive you all, standing in the wind of my blessedness with arms open to receive. And I want to fill you with my Holy Spirit until you are fat and full of my very best anointed blessings that will bring forth the treasure of excellence and the excellence of treasure, which is the love of God. And now in this hour, the rays of glory from off the Lord's heart of hearts, the resplendence thereof is shining in the heavens, glistening and shimmering beautifully and boldly, blue, sapphire blue, the crystalline sapphire sea of the Lord's bottomless love, of the sea and great ocean of his adoration. For he does not love us, he adores us, because we are angels in the flesh. The second that we leave unto glory, we are as sinless as the day that we were born. That is part of the secret of the mystery of Revelation 10:7. And so the Lord says unto one and all, he says, come unto me and rest, says our good shepherd, over all the flocks of men. And he speaks to the atheists, he speaks to those of Hinduism and Buddhism and Mormonism and Hyperionism and every other ism that has ever been and isms yet born. And he speaks unto all of them. And he says it has never been about anyone's labor or ability, lest any man boast, or what anyone could do, should do, might have done, or will do. It's never been about our actions, other than keeping him alive within our chest as our beloved love of the ages, which has carried mankind through the darkest nights of our own man's inhumanity towards man. So the Lord says, change direction and find my love, find me, and let me become your highest pursuit and your mission upon earth. Seek ye first my kingdom of love, and all shall be added unto you. And I shall bring you my highest heart's desire, even the desire of my heart of hearts. And then I shall refresh you from within, and I will cause your harp to leap for joy unspeakable as you become lost within the labyrinth of my love, a maze to which there is no rescue. For once people fall within the rock will never fall and grind them to a powder, spiritual or otherwise. And when any child of love loses themselves within me, says the Lord, they shall immediately find their greatest abundancy of delight born through his most lofty love unleashed, pouring out the floodgates of heaven over all flesh, as Joel 2 and Acts 2 has foretold for these latter days. And so the abundancy, a cornucopia of delight now comes forth, a treasure trove of the greatest treasure of excellence, coming from he who is the priceless pearl of great reward. And for all those with ears to hear, joy shall then come forth for them as they open their hearts to receive from his heart of hearts, as a brand new dawning day explodes within. For these are the days of Jeremiah 31, and these are the days of Isaiah 25. And in these days, he desires to remove all yoke of spiritual bondage off all people in favor of exalting loving spirituality. It's the flip side. And in these days, he promises to remove all shame and all guilt off all people that will stand upon his latter-day mountain of Isaiah 2 and Micah 4. And this has always been this mountain of 13,000 YouTube videos, all ignored for the most part. And then shall the wise find their excellence of happiness as they walk in a brand new fresh anointing of love that shall begin oozing all over them like the sweetest dripping honey. And blessed shall they be. And within these last days of man's soon ending age of grace that has now officially ended, the moment that the covenant was given unto mankind. Almost 2 years ago, I've been preaching to white noise. And so the Lord says, and I will keep pouring out my spirit of love upon all believers of love. For that is the secret name of Christ, declares the Lord. Every knee will bow to that name. Every tongue will confess love. For love, our Lord thereof, is the name above all other names. And it shall be proved absolutely true, says the Spirit of comfort, that my greatest mercy has always been underrated, as the Lord now allows it to rain upon the just and the unjust alike. And that is what his love has always been. And so the Lord says, "For I care not what foolishness men believe through their own narrow-mindedness, if they choose to love their enemies as well as their neighbors. All doctrines that toss men to and fro about on a sea of error has never been anything like what they have imagined. White has become black. Black has become white. There is no one on earth that would let Jesus preach his true message of love, because his message is a message of inclusion. All are included that keeps their love alive till the end. Christianity is a message of exclusion. All are excluded because it was stolen, the blessing of love. 2,000 years ago, early Christians, without knowing what they were doing, just ignorant, didn't mean bad by it, but they grabbed all the Hebrew books and then they declared, 'And we are Israel, and all the prophecy is for us.' But guess what? In the latter days, God promised Israel, the nation of Israel, to whom Isaiah prophesied to. And he wrote in Jeremiah 31:1 that in the latter days, he would be their God. He would give them their covenant that he had promised them and given them the words for, and said in the latter days it would come. And in the latter days he has given them a new name, Isaiah 62:2. Their name is Chrislam. And because Israel has now inherited all mankind. Because you see, that covenant for the kingdom age, that is to tear down all kingdoms of man's imagination, according to Jeremiah 1:10 and Haggai 2:2, that's not built solely upon the Lord's unconditional love. That covenant, it was always correctly addressed to Israel in Jeremiah 31:1 and to all mankind in Jeremiah 32:27, which used to be one fluid chapter until scribes numbered it and tore the covenant in half. So it's time to receive now, therefore, a fresh anointing for all that will bow into the glorious rays of the Lord's mercy, pouring out from his mercy seat on high. Prepare now for fresh power and fresh winds of the Spirit of blessedness pouring out from heaven. And for the great whirlwind of the Lord's blessedness will now propel all people willing to soar high upon the Lord's eagles of the eons, whitest wings, as he carries them from grace to grace and from glory to glory, as he fulfills them and completes us and empowers us and gives us brilliant successes within his love, flowing for one another by his Spirit of love and his Spirit of life that should be living in us, renewed as a little child, as a verb. So flame back on like Johnny Torch, says the Lord. Let unity of mankind begin, because his most passionate prayer in Gethsemane has always been for our unity, which he knew he was sending for these latter days. So it is time to restore now sanity unto all people beloved of him. And so, as this word of love is meditated upon, the Lord says, "My overflowing spirit of charity will lift up the downcast, so defeat might become victory, as depression flees like a demon, frightened by my most radiant glory of love throughout all the ages ahead. Be therefore bold and strong within me, for I shall now fortify all loving hearts, and I shall strengthen you as I help you naturally and supernaturally through angelic hands as well. Truly, truly shall your heart become knit with mine, says our roaring lion of Zion, who's roaring louder than ever before, calling each of our names as if we were the only one. And he says, and I will have my thoughts within you, And I shall also give all people of love, wishing to shine as the stars, to give all of us abundant courage so that we can have his thoughts inside of our heart of hearts, always, evermore. Verily, verily, he says, you shall be filled for all people, embracing my servant Daniel. You shall be filled with my strongest might of love, and my adoration will bring you my greatest glory, power of hope springing forth eternally within, so that all people following in the road that Daniel is pointing to, the latter day Daniel, who has embraced his destiny of Daniel 12:13, so that you might shine as the sun, as Daniel the prophet foretold in Daniel 12. So these are the days of Elijah, the days of Shiloh, one whose eyes are red and dull of wine, one whose soul is not upright, but the just damn well better live by my faith, because there is no damn good man, not even one, Romans 3:10. And so it's time to stand up straight and tall and face all adversity with all determination to overcome it all within by love that is within us. For greater is love within us than a loveless world thinks that they have with all their conditional love. And so the Lord's Spirit of everlasting truth shall now reside in all people believing in his messenger. And the Lord says, and I shall give you my loudest roar and lion's teeth, that my people of my pride, which is the name of a family of lions, so that my pride might assault the enemy, the fallen satanic realm, even though Diablo, Satan, Beelzebub has been removed in accordance with Revelation 12 in the latter days, because he was the accuser of the brethren. And he can accuse no more, because God is saying, I have forgiven you and I will never remember it. And so the Lord says, I will write my law and my love upon your hearts. Beyond that, none will ever even need to be taught of me anymore, saith the Lord God Almighty, for all who know me, for all who love as a child, and for all not committing blasphemy of the Holy Spirit, they already know me, for they are born of me, for I am love within them. And I shall be their friend, I will be their partner, and I shall be their Lord. And no more shall anyone need to ever worry about their salvation, which is secure. And no more shall anyone need to be intimidated, as he now begins to remove all fear of evil's wickedness from all obedient souls of the Lord's faithful few. For love abandons all fear and causes triumph to come forth from out of any forsaken optimism. And in Jesus' mighty name, I ask you to repent of your heresy against me, your blaspheme against me. I am Elijah, and the whole world of Christianity. Judgment starts at the house of God. You all have a false Jesus, who is not the good shepherd of all the flocks of man. When God says, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that meant, I am their God, and they are mine. No one can have them. And that is what a good shepherd over all the flocks of man means, because the message was always for everyone. That's why God pours the Spirit upon everyone, because they are all his children, not just Christians. You just have the biggest cult of all of them. You have a respecter of God, a God that is a respecter of man, likes you best. And for that reason, that's right there, you got a false God. He's a sinner God. And you got a God of conditional love. And when you got a God of conditional love, you might as well sit on that and rotate. He's always been a fake fucker. Your God, the true God, is a God of unconditional love in accordance with his law of his love. Him saying, I am your God. You are my people. I forgive you and never will remember it. That's why all faith is now obsolete, as Hebrews 8 says. Paul reiterated, when you hear, I am your God, you are my people, the covenant comes, that's it, game over. And I am Elijah, and I am Shiloh, and I am Daniel. It's all the same guy. But know that I am the writer, line by line, precept by precept, the strong and mighty one coming forth as a destroying storm, pulling down distortionalities so the wise might not have to look through glass darkly no more. And I am the writer of Deuteronomy 18:18's prophecy, the end time revelator. And so it came to pass after Christ ascended into heaven. In Acts 3:21, Peter said, remember what Moses said in Deuteronomy 18:18? Yeah, it's about that end time messenger, Shiloh, Elijah of Malachi 4:6, Shiloh of Genesis 49:12. Who holds the scepter of all authority. Yeah, that guy. If that restoration does not happen, yeah, the one that Jesus was talking about, Matthew 17:11, that surely Elijah would come forth first and restore all things. If that guy does not have anyone paying attention, and then the earth would be destroyed. Zephaniah 1, no birds, no fish, no mankind. People, I have been preaching my face off for 2 friggin' years, and I come at you with stammering, shocking lips, and I've swore a couple times here along the way. Scorn lips, Isaiah 28 says, because I have done everything in vain, Isaiah 49:4. The very things that people are waiting for in their outdated, obsolete religion that no one will even look for any of the answers to, I'm giving all the answers here. The veil is now being removed from off all the nations, as it is written in Isaiah 25, so the earth might not be destroyed, as Isaiah 24 said. But if this restoration is not embraced, Jesus Christ cannot come back, and these days cannot be cut short, as Matthew 24:22 has said, and then every damn one of us will perish, and we're all going to kiss our asses goodbye.